Good afternoon, all of you. This is Dr. Konda Nageshwar, Director, OUCIP. This lecture by Professor Sumita Roy, ma'am, Senior Professor, Retired Professor of English, former Director of my center, OUCIP. Professor Sumita Roy, ma'am, was a Professor of English and Director for OUCIP for a long time. Ma'am worked as the head of the Department of English, and ma'am was the director for ELTC, Usmani University. Ma'am has 31 years of research experience, and she is one of the eminent academicians in the country. Ma'am produced 15 PhDs and almost 14 MPhils. And Professor Sumita Roy was the principal investigator for 4 research projects sponsored by UGC. Ma'am has given number of lectures. In fact, Professor Sumita Roy, ma'am, requires no introduction among the English fraternity because everybody knows her name. Millions of viewers are there on YouTube programs, impact programs. She published 47 books and 52 articles, delivered more than 600 lectures, and her lectures uploaded on YouTube have about 6 million viewers. Ma'am presented 34 research publication papers at national and international level. In the year 2006, Professor Sumita Roy was conferred with Books on Books Award. She was member for many committees, number of committees. And when I came to know Usmani University, during all these 12, 13 years of my service, before that as a government lecturer, we used to attend many lectures. She has been a resource person at UGC refresher courses, orientation programs, workshops, seminars. She has been encouraging the young teachers, young scholars in the department. And she gave a lot of opportunities to the young teachers in the department when she was the head of the Department of English, Usmani University. Under her able guidance, Usmani University Department of English got SAP DRS, and we worked together as the junior colleague to Professor Sumita Roy, ma'am. I was benefited by her lectures and her able administration. Thank you, ma'am, for accepting our invitation to give your time and your valuable insights with us on the topic Aldous Huxley's perennial philosophy, spirituality as unity. We all know this pandemic has illustrated the limitations of material preoccupation and highlighted the spiritual and various dimensions as unifying for the world. At this juncture, madam's interested area, ma'am worked a lot on this area. Now may I invite Professor Sumita Roy, ma'am, to give a lecture on Aldous Huxley's perennial philosophy, spirituality as unity. Thank you, ma'am.
Namaste and greetings to all of you, including my very dear younger colleague, who is now the director of AUSIP, Dr. Konda Nageshwar Rao. I must first thank him for calling me to speak to all of you, share my ideas, because for my PhD, one of the authors was Huxley, very dear to me. And also, I would like to congratulate Dr. Konda Nageshwar Rao, because he's doing a wonderful job. When I look back at the center, AUSIP, where I also was director, his own supervisor, Professor Karnakar, was also director. And then we take see him taking over the legacy of this excellent institution, I really feel very proud of you. And you have really adapted well to this pandemic situation by organizing these online lectures. You know, innovation is the name of progress, of research. And you're doing a wonderful job. Congratulations, and keep up the good work. I'm happy that some participants are here. Of course, many people asked me. I told them to watch it on YouTube. I'm sure it's getting streamed on YouTube also. Many of you might have been my students. Some of you might have been my colleagues at different points of time. And together, all of us are going to have a small discussion on this. The director told me I could take 45 minutes, so I will try not to extend more than that. When we talk about Huxley, now look at the few key words we have in the topic. There's Huxley, there's perennial philosophy, there is spirituality, and there is unity. So I would like to concentrate on all these keywords. We begin with Aldous Huxley. Aldous Huxley was an experimenter with the various levels of consciousness. He was constantly talking about the abilities of the human consciousness. He was born in a literary and scientific family on both sides. And therefore, he began with skepticism, a very scientific skepticism, and then he evolved into an establishment of reality. He said that there is a reality which we can explore by exploring the levels of consciousness. This, he thought, the psychologist and the moral experiments can do much better. He said theologians and philosophers can also do it, no doubt about it. But a better method is the method of experimentation. Along with his friends and colleagues, Gerald Hurd and Christopher Isherwood, Aldous Huxley was a student of Swami Prabhavanandaji, who was the minister in charge of Vedanta Society of Southern California. All of you know how Vivekananda established these Vedanta centers. And for these important writers of that time, you know, Huxley almost spans 1894, he was born, and 1963, he was no more. So between this year, almost a 50-year span he has, and this is what we have to keep in mind when we are looking at his ideas. Now, these people, they got a spiritual education. In fact, he gave many lectures also. And if you read the Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna, you will find Huxley's foreword to the Gospel. He writes about how a spiritual biography or a hagiography can be. So when we talk about the perennial philosophy, you know, this is the text I thought I could discuss because that's very relevant today. The perennial philosophy, published in 1945, was for establishing the unity of human spiritual endeavor. He's not talking about a single country or a single tradition. He's talking about a global tradition, a global ground for this spirituality. And this is what he says, that human endeavor, right from the earliest times of history to the present, have had the material prosperity, and on the other side, beyond the material prosperity, is the spiritual dimension. So when we talk about this, we are thought, you know, we come to the pandemic, as Dr. Kondal mentioned just now. You know, today we are in a pandemic where we have a dichotomy, it seems, between the struggle for existence and contemplative thinking. You know, on the one side is the thinker, and on the other side is the person who's struggling to live, either physical or mental health. These are all important. Now, what we are talking about today is that 2020 has overturned all what we thought of as normal. You know, there are alterations in our consciousness. Each day we are expanding our consciousness. Last April 2020, I didn't know how to give an online lecture. Today, almost every, you know, week, 2-3 lectures I can give very easily. I have no problem at all. What happened? There is an expansion of our abilities. There is an expansion of our endeavors. That is why I appreciated Dr. Kunda Nageshwar Rao's effort, because he did not sit back and say, oh, pandemic. He said, online lectures. AUSIP keeps alive by all these traditions. So today what we have, a new dimension of consciousness, which of course Huxley might not have experienced. And that is what we call as the new normal. You know, we are using this term today, new normal. So what is this new normal except an exploration of our consciousness? Now, Aldous Huxley speaks in Perennial Philosophy about sustainability, which is a very popular term in the 21st century. You know, everybody is talking about sustainable development, sustainable this or sustainable that. Huxley is talking about sustainable evolution. Now, look at this term, which is a futuristic term. You know, sustainable evolution implies changing. You know, we have today the artificial intelligence, we have machine learning, etc. These are all anticipated by this scientific-oriented writer, because Huxley was a writer of science fiction and, of course, an essayist and a philosopher, an experimenter. All these were his various aspects. So the need of the hour is mental health, which implies sustainable evolution. We will never have, you know, the ability to face the pandemic unless we look at this sustainability. And that is the strength of mind. This is important. Now, Huxley was throughout, you know, in his other books also, like Ends and Means, Doors of Perception, etc. He's talking about unification of consciousness. This is a very important point. Now, in consciousness studies, we speak about the level of the participatory consciousness. You know, think of us as participating in this program. That is the level we call participatory. But we have another level, and that we call as the witness consciousness. Now, the witness is also there, participatory is also there. When I speak, I not only participate, but I also analyze. Am I saying what is worth saying? Or when you listen, you analyze. Is this worth hearing? Therefore, we have these channels of consciousness. And we need to constantly put them together, because that is where unification comes. The levels of consciousness are there. For instance, in Mandukya Upanishad, which of course Huxley must have studied under Swami Prabhavanandaji, it says, you know, we have Jagrut, that is the waking state. Then we have the Sapna, the dream state. Then we have the highest, that is, you know, we go like that to the highest, which is Turiya. So that state is what is the human endeavor. When we are talking about sustainable evolution, we are talking about this endeavor. So we come to perennial philosophy after a lifetime of, you know, experimenting with consciousness, of writing so many novels, which were mainly novels of ideas, because he was exploring the ability of the human mind. And if you read all his novels also, you come across this idea. The idea is the expansive, sustainable, evolving consciousness. So in the perennial philosophy, let me quote from perennial philosophy, because I want to now talk to you about the unity and the spirituality dimension. You know, why did I say spirituality as unity? Today we have unity. The virus is going everywhere. You know, the virus is making us all united. White or black, rich or poor, educated or uneducated, you know, staying in the east or west, a sunny climate or a cold climate, all are unified. You know, the virus is unifying. So that is one level of unity. It is a very negative kind of unity, that all of us are susceptible. But there is a positive unity. You know, it's something like the World Wide Web of Internet. This World Wide Web, which we are talking about, is of human empathy. You know, a connective link between the human consciousness, the individual human consciousness, and the cosmic consciousness, which makes the blueprint of the world. But this is where Huxley is still relevant, you know, so many years later, so many decades later. Imagine 63 to almost, you know, we have come now to the next 2023 is not far away. So you can imagine a long gap of time, but still the relevance is there because he's talking about this. So I thought I would like to read this small quote from Huxley. This is the beginning in the introduction of perennial philosophy. He says this. He says, rudiments of perennial philosophy may be found among the traditionally lore of primitive peoples. You know, rudiments of perennial philosophy. Where does he find? He finds it even in the primitive people. In every region of the world. Now, I have said about unification. You know, look at this idea. Avidya. You know, the paravidya, the higher level, the aparavidya, you know, what we are going to make use of. This he compares to the ground, the divine ground, which we talk about in the mystical Christian tradition. Today we say cosmic consciousness. We don't use the word God anymore. So he's not using this word God anywhere, but he's using ideas from religion to say that religion has various levels. You know, he talks about three levels. We are going to discuss only one of them. I'll come to it slightly later. Now, let us talk about this concept from the idea of, you know, one of the quotations which he gives. Again, the comparative element, I'm keeping that alive. I told you about paravidya, aparavidya, the divine ground which is beyond temporal and spatial. Teachers, we can't help repeating, you know, I'm repeating myself, but I thought I should make that clear. Now, he quotes Meister Eckhart, and he gives the idea from nothingness to nothingness. This Eliot has also said in his Wasteland, you know, nothingness. The concept of nothingness is a positive concept on one side, and it is also a negative concept on another side. Now, for instance, the positivity is where you have everything and you renounce it. That is nothingness in its positivity. But to arrive at that point, we have to evolve. You know, I'm using the word evolution many times. We have to evolve from a time when we have nothing and we desire everything. We hanker for everything because we don't have anything. Once we have everything, we give up everything. So first, without having, that is nothingness, negative. Renouncing is nothingness, positive. So he uses this idea, nothingness to nothingness. He gives the quotation of Eckhart. I'm not using my own words. And this he compares with the idea of neti neti. You know, neti neti is an Upanishadic idea, which we have in the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. This idea of not this, not this, he compares to neti neti. Because we have this idea that, you know, is this what you're looking for? No, it isn't. Is this what you're looking for? You know, children had games like this, you know, 20 questions or just a minute. Imagine these are the spiritual games which were played thousands of years ago in our tradition, which have parallels in all other traditions of the world. It is not a tradition which is only ours and, you know, we need to hold on to it. Huxley is showing that it is a global tradition, that it is found everywhere. Echoes of these ideas are found everywhere. Maybe they are not borrowed from anywhere. There, that is where the unification, the spiritual unification of humanity is established. Now, this point is very, very significant because unless we have the spiritual unity, you have many books on this. You know, parallel developments between Indian thought and Greek thought or Chinese thought and Indian thought, There are many matter. The mind, you know, the human mind is like a computer. And matter, you know, dust thou art, to dust returnest. That is our body. So the matter, you know, the panchabhutas, which we call them. So this mind and matter going together, and that is the attitudes and the actions. You know, what we teach in soft skills today very often, attitude and behavior. That also he is assuming, you know, he is anticipating almost, you know, 8 decades before this. So what is he trying to tell us here? He's trying to say that in the 27 chapters of perennial philosophy, he's going to explore how the mind of a single individual can impact the consciousness expansion exercise of entire humanity. The entire humanity needs to have this conscious evolution. The conscious evolution is the only method of going forward. So if we have a single quotation, this quotation might impact our mind in such a way that we go further and further. So I have a little more time. Let me now go into the details of what I'm trying to tell you. I'm talking only about the first chapter, possibly a little bit about the second chapter, not more than that. In fact, the ground which I told you about is from the second chapter. You know, the ground of all being, the unification as the ground. This is in the second chapter. But all the chapters are very interesting. I cannot go into all of them because Huxley is exploring a variety of themes. Let us now talk about only the first chapter. The title of the first chapter is very significant. It is, Thou Art That. That is the title of the first chapter. Perennial philosophy opens with this titled first chapter. And that is, Thou Art That, compared to Tattvamasi. Tattvamasi, all of us are familiar with, because it is our own tradition. But this was a very difficult thing for the global concept, because if you say Tattvamasi, it might be understood in certain places, it might not be understood in some other places. So when he said, Thou Art That, what was he trying to say? The first point he was trying to put is that we have to find out what is this that. We have to remember that Huxley comes from a family of scientists. So he was very aware of science. In fact, he was also going into science, but he had some issues with his mind, with his eyes. So he could not go into scientific research and scientific study. But he had that, you know, developed scientific sensibility. Therefore, he would dissect this title as a scientist would dissect this title. And that is, he would say, what is this that? This is the question. Thou art that. Now, thou obviously is all of us, the humanity, each individual one of us. Now, thou art that. What is that which you are? Here he says that we have two dimensions. One is the material dimension. I am that. Who am I? You got a huge introduction from Kunda Nageshwar Rao, who I am, including my name. You can see my picture on your screens now, I assume. That is one level of me. But is that the only level of me? Now look at what is that. That is the spiritual dimension. That is the idea of spirituality. So we have one dimension, that is the materialistic dimension. We have another dimension, and that is the level of the mind which is not material. The brain is material. The thoughts are like electric currents. And the mind is non-material. Because we are talking about the mind as consciousness. Why we are talking about the mind as consciousness is because when we are doing a basic job, like, you know, the daily labor, they are doing job with their hands, but they are also using some part of their mental energy. Then you come to a higher level, the university professor, using another level of energy. Then you go to the saints and sages, you go to the mystics, they are using another level of energy. These are all not the physical energy. These are all the mental energies. So that implies a conglomerate of all these energies. You know, the human form is made out of all these energies. I'm alive, I have the energy embedded in this physical form. I die, the energy leaves. But where does it go? The scientist says that energy is neither created nor destroyed. So what does it mean? If the dead body or the dead plant or a dead animal loses the energy, then where does the energy go? It merges into a whole unit of energy, which we call as the cosmic consciousness. So thou art that. What are you? You are an individual form of that cosmic consciousness. Remember the great poets who have spoken about this idea. We have Huxley, who has done this, you know, in perennial philosophy. But do you remember the poems of Hopkins? Or you remember, you know, the mysticism of great saints like Julian of Norwich, etc. You know, that mystical experience which Blake is mentioning in Blake's poetry, you know, also Wordsworth is mentioning in his pantheistic idea. These are all the point of that. So when he says, thou art that, what is he implying? He is implying that apart from your personality known to you, there are endless possibilities of consciousness. These consciousness levels will become the point, the springboard for your leap into a higher evolutionary consciousness. If you take these quotations, so he gives you some quotations. You know, I'll read out a few of the names of people whom he's quoted. I will not be able to quote anything much from there. Eckhart, I've already told you. Michael Eckhart, very important thinker, German philosopher. Then we have William Law, you know, of Church of England. William Law was, of course, he lost his reputation. This was 17th century. Then you have, you know, this is in the order in which the first chapter gives it. Then you have this story of Shvetaketu. I'm sure many of you know the story of Shvetaketu from the Chandogya Upanishad. You know, the father says, talks about knowledge. What did you learn? Tell me what you learned. And from here, you get the idea. And that idea is that you are going to benefit. You are going to be much better once you realize the point of knowledge. You realize the function of knowledge, because that is the step towards reality. Huxley is using reality with a capital R that you have to keep in mind. And throughout perennial philosophy, he's talking about this capital R with reality. So then he talks after this, he quotes Plotinus. Then he quotes Viveka Chudamani, Shankara's important text. Then from the Taoism, he quotes, I don't know how it is pronounced, Chang Tzu. This he quotes. After that, he quotes Mahayana Buddhism. You know, he begins with the comment about Gautam Buddha's methods. And he talks about how Buddha combines all the methods in order to come at that, you know, the concept of Nirvana, that concept, how he arrives at. And he traces the similarities and differences between all the traditions and between the various branches of Buddhism. This also he does a marvelous idea. So this, you know, mentioning Gautama Buddha in the beginning, he starts. So he quotes here Mahayana Buddhism. After that, he quotes Kabir Das. Kabir Das is a bhakti poet. And Kabir Das is also speaking about this concept that, you know, you have to go beyond your limitations. The limitations are the encircling point of our body or our mind, our consciousness. It keeps us within a circumference. We have to go beyond this circumference. This was the idea of the bhakti poets. Remember that bhakti poetry is a real revolution because it broke the caste system which was holding on to the culture of India. And this was, you know, not only religion, region, caste, color, gender, language, everything was subverted in bhakti poetry. That, of course, is another area, very favorite of mine, maybe some other forum. Then he quotes Saint Catherine of Genoa, Saint Bernard, and so on. You know, the list goes on and on. So he says that suppose we take Christianity, we take Hinduism, we take Sufi Islam, we take Buddhism, and, you know, we also take Taoism, etc. He quotes also from the, you know, Tibetan Book of the Dead. That also he quotes. So when we take all these ideas, then he says that the idea of Trinity is there in all of them. You know, this is a very important idea. We grew up in convent schools. So, you know, whenever we had anything, we would do like that. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. This idea was there. So using that Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, he says about Hinduism, Brahma, Vishnu, Maheshwar, he says, the Holy Trinity. Then he talks about the Dharmakaya. Then he talks about the Sambhogakaya. And he talks about the Nirmanakaya. This is in Buddhism. He says, of course, I have very little knowledge of Buddhism, so I won't go into commenting on all of them. But he gives a clear description of the levels at which evolution takes place. Because as far as deity is concerned, as far as God is concerned, Buddhism doesn't have that. That concept is not there for them. So what they are doing is by transmigration, they are going towards higher and higher levels of consciousness. This suited Huxley completely. So he uses these terms and he gives a lot of explanation about these terms. Then Sufism, he speaks about Sufism also. And then he says, Al-Haq at one level, Al-Haq you have, then you have Allah, and then you have the Prophet. The Prophet is the Prophet of Allah. And then you have Al-Haq. These are similarities he finds. That is why I thought we should speak in terms of spirituality as unity. Today, we really need to get in touch with each other, not physically. You know, we have physical distancing. We have to wear a mask and, you know, keep far away from each other. We have. But can you imagine that at some point we are connecting with each other? And at that point where we are connecting with each other, there is what we have to think about. If we start thinking in those terms, we come to that point which Huxley mentions again and again in Perennial Philosophy. He mentions the idea that you have to now explore your own consciousness. This he calls as the experimental level. Now, each individual exploring their level of consciousness realizes that the human potential is endless. Many of you might be teachers. I can give you an example here. You know, the first day we went to teach, I remember we had to prepare for 5 hours. And when I went to the class, my hands were shivering, my legs were shivering, my lips were moving. You know, I couldn't utter many things. Nervousness. What happened after 5 or 10 or 15 years? No need for preparing. No need. Only preparation you do is keeping update with your subject. You know all the recent happenings which are going on in your area of specialization. You don't really prepare for a class. It happens. So what happened? Consciousness expanded. Our capabilities evolved. The same teacher in 1 year, the same teacher 20 years later is a different idea altogether. Of course, the style remains the same, the ideas might remain the same, but there is an internal alteration. There is a change which is happening internally. This we have to analyze. This is what Huxley is trying to say. Now, what is perennial about it? Perennial because right from Stone Age or, you know, the caveman, they've been trying to explore this possibility. Today in 2021, we are still exploring these possibilities. Because, like Isaac Newton said, I see further because I stand on the shoulders of giants. You know, earlier scientists are giants. I'm standing on their shoulder. Therefore, I can see further. That is our research. You know, we read all the books, all the ideas others have given. Then we think of our own contribution to this branch of knowledge. So Huxley is talking about something very practical. And he's calling it perennial. Perennial means everlasting. That which is immortal, that which doesn't end. That is what spirituality is. You see how the echo between these two terms is there? The spirituality on one side, I'm taking up the time periodically, please don't mind, because I don't want to exceed my time. Now, on one side, you have spirituality, and on the other side, you have individual effort. Together, if all individuals are working together, we teach today what is called as teamwork. Therefore, what we find is that slowly, this expanding exercises are going on. Scientific discoveries, changes in lifestyle, economic progress, all these are developments. But these are developments on the material plane. Huxley says that the scientist is doing wonderful work for knowledge, but the instrument is limited. Why does he say instrument is limited? Because scientists of his age ruled out religion and philosophy and spirituality. They said, nay, there is no God. You know, religion is opium and so on. So Huxley is saying that is because the instrument is limited. Now, the instrument is your mind, is your consciousness. I can give you the example of a prism. You know, we see with our eyes white light, but light is not white in color. It is the instrument which is wrong. The instrument which is limited. You bring a prism, you see 7 colors. With the same eye, you see 7 colors. What did you do? You supplemented your instrument with another instrument. So scientific knowledge needs to be supplemented. That is why Einstein felt that one of them, science and spirituality, you know, science is blind and spirituality is lame and so on, he said. So they have to work together. And as a, you know, person who had grounding and training in science, a person who was experimenting with consciousness, Huxley felt that here is an area where unification is possible and experimentation is necessary. So perennial philosophy is a text which impels us to experiment. If we can do that kind of experiment, it is better. Because Huxley says, you know, very clearly he says that human potential is unlimited. I'm not quoting because I don't remember. You know, I did my research maybe 30, 40 years back. So, but I'm just trying to recollect that, you know, potentiality is immense, but it is underutilized. It is unutilized. It is not explored. Nobody has made use of it. So what is the suggestion here? If you want to find that unity, if you want to explore that spirituality, you have to experiment with your consciousness, sharing this experiment with each other, like these great philosophers who he has quoted in this text, is one way of exploration. I think I've finished my 45 minutes. Thank you very much. Now it is open to questions. If you have any questions, feel free.
Thank you very much, ma'am, for your wonderful presentation. Now it's open for discussion. Any doubts, if anybody wants to interact with the ma'am, you are welcome. Ma'am, basically, as you said, perennial philosophy is talking about spirituality and knowledge-based learning and all. How do we look at this perennial philosophy in the post-colonial dialectics? No, now we have different types of literature and different sets of arguments are coming out. How do we look at the perennial philosophy? Basically, it was a British comparative study of spiritual aspects at the junction. How do we look at this philosophy?
Okay, now let me make one very important point. You know, we are using the term post-colonial. I think we should come out of post-colonial, because post-colonial would still be some hangover of the colonizer. I think we have come out of that hangover. And that is why when I use the word unity, I used it with a lot of, thought, because we are not categorizing or we are not fragmenting. Look at the term commonwealth, for example. No, we are not going to, talk about the idea of commonwealth anymore, because there is no wealth and it is not common at all. So when we have the, if you want to use the idea of, the colonies having broken without using that red rag called post-colonialism, it is a real red rag. We are in the 21st century. Why are we mentioning these things? One is that, in globalization, pre-colony, there was no globalization. There was colonization. Post-colonial, it have began with Commonwealth, etc. But in the 21st century, the real globalization came where hierarchy is getting lost. Where postmodernism in 1950s and 60s was talking about the breakdown of hierarchy, decentering. So that concept of decentering is available in our Vedas itself. It's not 1950s. It is thousands of years old when we talk about the concept of aporosheya. Reader response theory, or the theory of the authorless text, death of the author, etc., is the aporosheya concept. Vedas were aporosheya literature. You don't have a name of an author for Vedas. So when we categorize it as post-colonial, I would think that that is a very small fragment. It is like time. If you remember Henry James, he would say that consciousness is like, you have a string, and beyond the string you cannot go. Or it is like a cave, Plato said, Greek philosopher. It's like a cave. You can't go beyond the cave. So like that, post-colonial is like, small boundary. We need to expand that boundary with the term of globalization, because if we did not have globalization so much, I think the virus would not have spread. It is because we are constantly traveling, because we are going elsewhere. Every member who lives in India has a member living somewhere in the world. We have diasporas all over the world. So this concept of diaspora, this concept of, having been ruled by colonies or being considered as colonies, this idea of hierarchy has to be removed in order to have real evolution of consciousness today, where we are not going to fragment anybody or anything. Just because my skin color is black, I'm not going to say that the white is superior. It is, on level. on part. Since you study American literature, you are learning this yourself, yes, isn't it? So yes, we are not going to make any kind of divisions here. And yes, consciousness is very difficult to divide because, as I told you, that consciousness is not something which is material. You know, today you might think like this. Tomorrow you might think totally differently. How have you been impacted? You might have been impacted by a person who was not colonized at all. Do you understand? The idea is that your consciousness might be altered by an idea from a country where you have not been, but which was not colonized at all. So it is not post-colonial. It is an idea which you borrow by choice. That is why I said the idea is to expand. Now, where expansion comes, there you have to, you know, manage also. Expansion cannot be, you know, expansion without control. The level of control is where the experimental dimension comes. You see a scientist in a laboratory, you know, 10 times in the night, the scientist goes and checks up whether the experiment is going properly or not. This we need to do. So if we can start thinking out of the box, you know, they are saying that in another 10 years, none of what we know as jobs will exist. It will all become different. So what we require? We require creativity. So applying this creativity, we go to that level. And what is that level? That level where we teach, we treat human beings as human, not as fragmented or not as divided. So we break the hierarchy and we look beyond it. It would be wonderful if you got an idea, you know, of expansion from Foucault, or, you know, you got an idea from Franz Fanon. You know, that would be wonderful, post-colonial theory, but you are using it for your expansion of consciousness. Yes, yes. Don't we do it? That, you know, the colonizers were terrible and we need to, you know, really give it back to them. We have Shashi Tharoor telling them, you know, what they did to our country and so on. These ideas are all there, but are they helping us to expand our consciousness, or are they suppressing our consciousness and making us follow somebody else? You know, this is the idea. And yes, if we start following somebody else, then we are not expanding our consciousness.
Ma'am, we received a couple of questions in the chat box. Shall I read it out, ma'am?
Please, please.
Mr. Upender, he has asked a question.
Upender is my student.
This Upender is S. Upender somewhere. He's not.
Yeah. He was our student in Arts College.
Yeah, ma'am. Sruti and Smriti. How Sruti and Smriti are connected to spirituality, he's asking in the chat box, ma'am.
Okay, very good question. You know, the idea is that spirituality is looking beyond what is available to the senses. That is, you know, seeing, touching, tasting, feeling, etc. These are our senses. So whatever is available to our senses is the one dimension. What is beyond our senses? You know, extrasensory perception, not unsensory. We don't become insensitive. But we go beyond the senses. That is called spirituality. Now, Shruti literature is telling us about spirituality, that everything is worthy of worship. You know, I gave you the examples of Vedas, for instance. If you go to the Veda, you need not, talk about the Vedas as scriptures or religious texts. You can read it as wonderful poetry. You know, if you read Rig Veda, it can be enjoyed as poetry. You know, the aesthetic dimension is there. So the aesthetic dimension as releasing your consciousness, that becomes spiritual. You know, a good dancer, a good singer says that I dedicate it to the higher being, that becomes spirituality. When you do your duty properly in the class, you know, you are spiritual, because that is what the Bhagavad Gita says. You know, that also is an oral literature, because it is said by one man to another man who says, I can't fight, please, don't ask me to fight. She says, no, no, you have to fight because that is your duty. You know, each of us has to do our duty. That is the most important thing. Then we become spiritual. So the Shruti literature is the literature which was not noted down. Why it is called is as Shruti is because it was listened and learned. I use the term orality. You know, orality is a very important concept in literature, which all of you can read up now. Google is our guru, so we can always read up everything. And this is what happens, that you have orality as Shruti. Now, Smriti was the comment. You know, a time comes when you have to give comments, like creativity and criticism. You know, Shakespeare wrote a lot of plays, and we go on interpreting Shakespeare's plays hundreds of years later. So our texts, our major spiritual texts, that is the Shruti literature, got interpreted. And people said something which they understood from it. You can imagine they were clearing their perceptions. Like Huxley says, doors of perception. So the eyes are the doors of our, you know, seeing. But the door of perception is inside. And we perceive. So when you are able to perceive the meaning of these Shruti texts, then you write down a commentary on it, it becomes the Smriti text. Smriti is to keep in mind, to memorize, to meditate upon. So that is how it became Smriti. Both Shruti and Smriti have something to do with the mental processes. And the mind is the seat for all our spirituality. Because from the mind, we begin to be spiritual. Therefore, we require, I was looking at Upinder's photograph and talking, but I think I should look at my camera. So Upinder, what happens is that these aspects, you know, when you read Shruti literature or you read Smriti literature, it alters your mind. One is that it brings rebellion to your mind, which is the first step to spirituality. Because questioning and doubting is very important for spiritual aspirants. Acceptance is not everything. Please understand that you accept passively, that is no experiment at all. Question, doubt, argue, comment. That is what the Smriti writers were doing. That is the Indian tradition. Don't take anything without fighting about it. So both Smriti and Shruti and Smriti have positive spiritual connections because any branch of knowledge has these consciousness expanding abilities, all branches of knowledge. And this is one branch of knowledge. Okay? I hope I've been able to answer you. Yeah, I can see the chat box. Don't worry. I feel that Huxley's ideas are most similar to the ideas presented in Bhagavad Gita. So obviously his ideas were very similar. But to limit him to Bhagavad Gita is not correct, because Huxley was a global personality. So since he was a Christian himself, his perspective of Bhagavad Gita is very fresh, and he makes use of ideas of Bhagavad Gita. But Bhagavad Gita has many parallels, according to him, in all the global traditions, need not be only Hindu tradition. So if you take Bhagavad Gita as a text which has global relevance, then many of his ideas are similar to Bhagavad Gita. Because we are familiar with Gita, it sounds similar to that. Whereas if you look at other traditions, if we go into other traditions and learn as much about those traditions as we learn about our own tradition, then we would find parallels in that also. So Bhagavad Gita is a wonderful manual, you know. It need not be treated as a scripture or as a spiritual text. It is a manual of proper behavior. It is a manual of life skills. You take it as a lab manual. The lab is here. Your mind is your laboratory. And the manual is your Bhagavad Gita. Do those experiments and you will find that there is relevance. Exactly what Huxley is saying, like you rightly said, you know, the questioner rightly said, Divya has rightly said that, you know, similarities to Bhagavad Gita are there. Yes, the idea is explore the possibilities, the potentialities of your consciousness. Explore everything which God has given you, if you believe in a God. And you will find that treasures are hidden there. If you don't explore, if you passively accept, if you sit back and allow propaganda to take hold of your mind, then no benefit comes. That is why expansion of consciousness, that is why comparison. You know why he uses perennial philosophy is to tell us, because we know only one tradition. You know, we cannot talk. If you ask me to speak about Sufism, I can't speak about it. I told you I know little about Buddhism. But what is Huxley doing? Huxley is putting it all together so that we might get excited and read about these other traditions also. So similarities are bound to be there because he uses extensively ideas of Bhagavad Gita. He uses Upanishadic ideas. He uses stories and, you know, Vivek Chudamani, I gave you the idea. All this he uses, but he uses it in such a way that comparative elements of other traditions are also there. Okay, I hope I'm able to answer you, Divya.
Any questions from the participants? So, almost all the students, you know, their doubts have been clarified by you, ma'am. A very wonderful session. You have explained everything so that participants are overwhelmed by your explanation and they were much satisfied by the lecture. Anyway, we receive the feedback from them also. We are sure that we will receive extraordinary feedback, wonderful feedback about you. Thank you, ma'am, for accepting our invitation to spare your valuable time by asking, you know, by my phone call, you accepted to give the lecture. Thank you very much, ma'am, for your wonderful support to the center. And you know the difficulties and everything of the center also. This is online lecture series is a year-long program, an initiation taken by the OUCIP after taking the charge as the director with all your blessings and the blessings by Professor Karunakar sir and you. And I am here to conduct all the things, ma'am. Dear participants, I must thankful to you for sparing your time. And I'm sure that by this time tomorrow, this number of viewers will go to a big number. Special thanks to Shamil, technical coordinator, who is taking care of all the things. And without his support, this program would not have been materialized. Thank you very much, ma'am, for your support, constant support, and also your wonderful lecture. And I'm sure this lecture is one of the best lectures in the series. And thank you very much, ma'am, for your support. Thank you very much.
Namaste to everybody. Thank you.